Good evening, everyone. I'm Sabine Fletchette. I'm the chapter director for Startup Grind in Munich. And it's my pleasure to welcome you today, this evening, for this very inspiring, I hope, Startup Grind and Fireside Chat. For those of you who don't know what Startup Grind is, it's a concept that came out of Silicon Valley in 2010, founded in 2010, and has spread around across the world in now, I guess, 220 cities and 98 countries. And what we try to do is we try to nurture entrepreneurs and their stories, and we try to provide and share their journey as they are building great companies. We also put on stage inventors, innovators, professors, and as such, we try to bring a local ecosystem around the entrepreneurship and here for me in Munich. Our Fireside Chat today is very special, first because I'm welcoming for the first time a woman, and since tomorrow is, I think, International Women Day, I think that was actually a great occasion for having a female entrepreneur with us. And second, our guest speaker is in the domain of social entrepreneurship. I got to know her through an appearance she made at TEDx 2 years and a half ago, where she explained how she's providing a second chance to prisoners by teaching them entrepreneurship, by teaching them how to become themselves entrepreneur and find a legal way of being successful. I got so inspired by her speech at TEDx 2 and a half ago that I actually joined as well her program as a coach, and I'm part of the mentoring squad of Leonhard. So this program, Unternehmertum für Gefangene in German, Entrepreneurship for Inmates. And this is my pleasure to have her on stage today, because she had this most inspiring story that actually made me rethink the way I was spending my time. So please welcome Maren, Jopen. Before we start, some of you know already, but we are recording this event, and this video will be available on our YouTube channel, Startup Grind Local. So for those who have concerns in terms of privacy, I would just avoid the camera and the smartphones with the pictures. Second, we will have also a session, a Q&A session for you guys, if you would like to you know, share your opinions and also ask questions to Maren. This will be at the end of the Fireside Chat, so that we can also switch off the camera, and then you can have all the comfort and the freedom to ask your questions. And finally, I would like also to introduce Barbara behind, who is for the first time going to record our Fireside Chat live and graphically, so from visual facilitators, and you will be able to admire her work after the Fireside Chat of summarizing graphically or visually our talk. So let's start. Thanks a lot, Maren, for coming here tonight. And I think everyone might not know who you are and what's the program about. So maybe let's start with the beginning. Where were you born? Like, what brought you to Munich? What was your childhood like?
Okay. Thank you for inviting me and to tell my story and to tell about Leonhard. I lived in the outskirts of Munich, in Gräfelfing, in a very protecting and loving area. My father was an entrepreneur. My mother was a medicine doctor. I had a 3 years older brother. So it was, I would say, a very normal and very comfortable life I had from the beginning on.
And how did you come up with entrepreneurship? Is it something that you had since the beginning, from the beginning on, like you wanted to build your own company or be selbstständig, freelance?
Not at all. No, I never thought to be an entrepreneur, to be honest. My father was one, and I saw him working all night and day. And my brother, who is 3 years older, saw entrepreneurial opportunities around every corner. He started to string tennis records at the tennis club with, I don't know, age of eight.
Okay.
And I was always standing there and watching at him. And I always thought that I'm not tough enough, or that I don't have the right ideas, or that it wouldn't fit with having a family to found my own company. So it was never a possibility for me.
So you went into studying business, normal career pattern, and
yes,
then went
yes.
into a corporate mm-hmm. world.
Yes, when I finished school, I had no idea what to do, neither who I am or what profession I would like to do. So mm-hmm. I started business economics at a cooperative university of education, Berufsakademie, mm-hmm. Where you study 3 months and work 3 months, always alternating, because I always preferred the practical work. And yes, my mother said, if you have this under your belt, you can do everything after that. So I just started this study.
Yeah. But your father at the time was already starting his initiative at the Technische Universität in Munich?
No, not at this time. At this time he had already pretty big telecommunication company. So he was working as an entrepreneur at this time.
Okay, because for those who might not know, Bernard Jopen was also very entrepreneurial in the sense that he built the Unternehmertum in Munich, was part of the Gründer. Mm-hmm. But that didn't appeal to you. You were more, I cannot do it, or I don't think that's my interest.
I thought that it wouldn't fit to my life to work all night and day, to be honest.
And a lot of people can share that view.
Well, I thought that I don't have the abilities to found my own company.
Yeah. Okay. So what did you do then?
Well,
career?
After university, I started to work in an event agency. And after 2 years, I changed to a big company, O2, Telefonica. Where I was working in the marketing department for 7 years, and I was responsible for the sponsorship department, and I had a little team and brand management, all this kind of things. Yes, for about 7 years. So I made a little bit of career in this mm-hmm. company, if you want.
And do you think that provided you with a lot of skills to then start your own company? Would you actually say that for a first-time entrepreneur, you would rather go into the corporate life a little bit?
Yes, I would definitely say. Today I benefit a lot from the things I learned during my cooperative work, and especially from the network I built in these times. I still know a lot of people from this time, and the program, the Leonhard program, only runs because of all these people. There are a lot of people volunteering, and so I would prefer not to found the company right away after university or whatever, collecting some experiences before.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so let's talk a little bit about Leonhard, just out of the audience, before you actually got to purchase your ticket for tonight. How many people did know about Leonhard? Okay, a handful of heads. So you went into corporate marketing O2 and then Leonhard. So I think this jump might need a little bit of an explanation. So how did you come up with the idea, or mm-hmm. how did the ideation, as we call it?
Well, my father read an article in the Financial Times Deutschland about a program in the USA, in Texas, called the Prison Entrepreneurship Program, where they teach inmates to become entrepreneurs. Mm-hmm. And at this time, as you said before, he was working at the Unternehmertum, so he was very interested in this field, and he thought about, oh, that's interesting, why not change from normal students to inmates? And then he flew to Texas and got to know the program. And when he returned, he was really, really fascinated what they did there. And he told me all the stories. So I decided to fly also to Texas. And this
So you actually went and visited the prison?
Yes, yes. So it was my first prison visit in Texas. It was a high security prison. And it was kind of weird to be there for the first time in prison.
But and they accept visitors like this?
No. We had to
get through like having a
yes permission and everything like that. It was well, and when I saw what these people in prison, how they accept their past and how they are ready to take responsibility for their lives and how they are ready to change and ready to do something good and to be good family fathers and role models, I was really thrilled about that. So we, my father and me, we flew back to Germany, and in the plane we decided, okay, we will make something similar in Germany.
But you still had the job at O2 at the time,
I had at the time, and well, I thought a long time how I should speak to my boss about that. And one day we went on a business trip to Madrid. And we were sitting in the plane, and it only lasted about 5 minutes. And I told him this whole story. And he said, Maren, your eyes didn't glow like that for a very long time in this job you're doing now. So I think you really have to do that. And he offered me right away to make a sabbatical for about 6 months to try it out. And I made this. And after 3 months, I think I quit my job to focus really on Leonhard.
And like in that situation, when you start like having this idea and there is absolutely nothing on the ground, right? It's just a concept at the moment. You've seen the prison in Texas, you have like a certain vision, but what does it take you to just like jump? Did you have any kids at the time, or like what was the risk that was involved in that decision?
Well, I was discussing the risk question a lot with my family, with my then partner, with my mother and with my brother, and everybody was telling me something about the risk. But I didn't see the risk, to be honest, because I knew that I'm well educated, and if it doesn't work out with Leonhard, I always can find another job again. I'm really conscious with that. And I really had a very strong gut feeling that this is the thing I have to do now. So it was no question for me. I just knew it, that I have to do it.
Okay, so it was like a gut feel and passion pushing you to do this.
Yes.
It's funny because basically like when people jump, I think I think it's the risk of failing that is the most prominent. It's what are people going to say if I fail? What are like the situation of you feel really not super positive about yourself, but you thought like even that experience will be beneficial and I will gain from even if it's a failure.
And I always had, and I still have the picture in my mind when I am sitting on a in a park when I'm 85 years old, I don't want to say, oh, maybe I should have done this in these times.
Okay.
So I know that every experience is very helpful, very
valuable.
Yes.
So you had the idea, you had some similar concept in Texas. How did the first few days work out? So how did you get the idea off the ground?
Yes, we had to contact Ministry of Justice, of course, and this was a very, very long time until they permitted us to make a very small pilot project.
Yeah, pilot. Test
project, yes. We started with about 7 parties. We don't speak very much English in prison, so I'm sorry, I'm a little bit out of training. Yeah, okay, but I do my best. So we were allowed to make a little training in one prison, And then, yeah, we made all the steps forward. But it lasted a very long time, of course. Nobody, we thought that we have the idea to heal the world and everybody will say, yes, here are you, welcome, do this. No, nobody said. They were all like, father and daughter want to heal prisoners by teaching them entrepreneurship. Aha. So this was...
How long did it take, actually? Like, we were in 2009 at the time, right? Or
yeah, we've made our first little class. We started in beginning of 2011.
Okay. And that was how many participants at the time?
7 at the beginning.
Okay.
No, 9 at the beginning. 9 at the beginning. Yes. But some weeks later, there were only 3 left.
Okay, yes. So maybe let's actually jump to Leonhard and the, mm-hmm. the business model. On what's the program? Can you maybe for those who don't know this initiative, mm-hmm. explain a little bit like what it consists of?
Okay, well, the idea is to teach inmates entrepreneurship so they can found their own company after release or find a job easier as an entrepreneurial thinking employee. And we train the inmates for about 20 weeks in prison.
Inside the prison.
Inside the prison. And there are two big blocks. One is the the basic of economics. And the second is very intensive personal coaching. Every participant finds his own vision, his own personal and professional vision and business idea, and they all write their own business plans. And this program only works because really a lot of people volunteering in this program, like you do. So every participant meets about 110 different external people during this 20 weeks.
Okay, the coach and mentor
coaching or
experts?
Yes, yes.
And so they get out of this training in business plan, investor relation, sales training, things like this. And do they then have like a diploma or something that they can show on their CV? Or?
Yes. At the beginning, they had a Leonhard diploma. but now they have a diploma of the Steinbach University because we are a Zertifikatslehrgang.
Yeah. Certificatslehrgang. You are a channel for diploma.
So our graduates then are innovation and business creation specialists.
And that's their title.
That's their title they get from us. Yeah.
And how does the selection process? I guess you know how many participants do you have today in one
about 18.
Program? 18. And how do you select them? I mean, mm-hmm. Is it from like overall in Germany, or do you focus on the Munich prison? Because I think the program is only in the Stadelheim prison in DC.
Right.
At the moment.
Yes. There are we recruit our participants in all Bavarian prisons. There are 36 Bavarian prisons. And they can apply for the program. And then we travel to all the prisons. We make a little roadshow where we show the program, and then we make like...
And if my number are correct, like there are 11,500
right.
prisoners in Bavaria.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes, yes.
So
yes.
You do this roadshow to all of them and everyone can apply?
No, not everyone can apply. The people have to be at the end of their prison time. We don't accept sexual offenders and serial fraud offenders for different reasons. And they have to know very well German because we only teach in German, mm-hmm. obviously. So these are some restrictions, mm-hmm. basics we have. And then we try to figure out in discussions with the people how they are ready to take responsibility for their own lives and how they are ready to change themselves. Because we know that we cannot change anybody, they can only change themselves. So we can help them in this process.
And how do you like, what motivates them to join that program? I mean, do you feel like they really want to change, or do they see other opportunities out there that they can, you know, run themselves?
It's very, very different. It's very different.
Okay.
Some were entrepreneurs in their own way before prison, and they see, oh, I can use the skills in future for legal things. Others just want to learn something. Others want to discover who they are, what their value is, whatever. So everybody who is in the program really has a complete different motivation to come to us.
And do they have the entrepreneurial skills to do this?
They do have, really, yes. Yes, we always say somebody who runs a drug ring, do you say that?
Drug network.
You know what I mean? Yes. Good. He has entrepreneurial skills. Yes. You have to know how you make your sales. You have to have a good risk management and all the stuff. So, yeah, it's kind of funny, but it's true. If I ask in our current class how many people did entrepreneurial work before, it's about 75%. So our aim is it to bring this into the right direction and to use this power. There's a lot of power. We had one graduate who was applying in a company, and they know that he has been in prison because they saw this TV thing we had before. And during the Bewerbungsgespräch,
the interview,
during the interview, they discovered that he already had the responsibility of 50 people. So they offered him a complete different job after that because they saw this
leadership skills.
Yeah. Yes.
There's another thing that I learned actually through your initiatives and at the prison. There's this little, I would say game, but little interview or questions that you raise at the beginning of each session just to kind of relax and get a smooth atmosphere. Can you maybe share this?
Yes, it's called Step to the Line. And we make a very big line on the floor during our events. We have several events where about 20, 30, 40, 50 people from the outside come. And all the inmates and all the guests, they are standing at this line. And I ask different questions. And every time anybody says yes
to the question,
he has to step to the line. And there you see where the differences are and what we all have in common. And what is very impressive is what we all have in common is when I ask, I did things in my life for what they could have punished me, but they didn't. And everybody.
Maybe we should actually ask this question here.
Yes. Sorry?
Maybe we should ask the question here.
Yeah, but now the trick is over, so I should have it before. Yes, and this is, people are always laughing and nervous, and this is funny, everybody's standing at the line. But you see that the barriers come down then, and they say, okay, in one kind, we are all the same.
Yeah, I think it's at the end, it's a question of luck. And you always talk about the environment which we've been raised into. So we had the chance of having a very protective environment, like a father which was present, who was a role model that we could follow. And I think these people who are like now sitting in Gefängnis, like didn't have this role model, had something different which they couldn't follow or had to follow because their environment was so insecure.
Yes, this is a very, very different question because we know that there are a lot of people who had a really, really bad childhood, but they didn't become criminal. So this is not an excuse, but it's an explanation. And in our current class, I think maybe about 60% of our participants have somebody who has been to prison, somebody in their family who has been to prison. So if your dad or your brother or your uncle or something, it's like a generation process. And we want to cut this. Yes.
Mm-hmm. And explain to me why, because I'm still a little bit struggling on the motivation. If I'm a drug dealer and I'm making thousands of euro right now because my network is working pretty well, and you asking me to go into a business which I might get, you know, a salary, maybe the minimum salary, the minimum wage, or do a bit better, maybe have like a business. I don't know. So you have examples, I think, of like a hip hop online shop, which is the one I'm actually catering to, or a tattoo studio, or even like an agency for search optimization. How do you explain to them that they might not earn as much as before, but, you know, maybe have like a more relaxed and a more valuable life because they do it legally? Mm.
Well, this is why we have to, or we make a pretty big visioning process at the beginning, because this new life has to, muss damit anstinken zu dem, was vorher gemacht hat. Ja? Also,
he needs to acknowledge basically what you've done and see the.
No. Yes. That's the point. So what we have to find out with them is, what is their heartbeat? What do they really want to do? And most people do not really want to be illegal or criminal, selling drugs or whatever they did. It's not their heartbeat. So we really try to find out what is their momentum. Yeah?
But if you find out that they want to go back, then we don't accept them.
Right. Yes.
So you run this for 20 weeks and you have all these, I would say, experts or donators that are donating their time to teach them sales training, interview training, investor experiences. And how do you finance this? Like, this is a pretty long program for 16 to 18 participants, mm-hmm. and twice a year, if I'm not mm-hmm. mistaken.
So do you want to know the financing today or the way, how we began?
The story.
Okay.
Where did you come from?
So there was no financing at the beginning, okay. Of course. Nobody wants to, there was nothing. So we had to bring our own savings to start the program. And then we made the first fundraising campaign, which was pretty successful. And we were really surprised that we can convince people to give their money for inmates, but it works. If you explain the program, people found it good. So we get a start capital, if you want. And then we get a funding from the European Social Fund for about 3.5 years. And this covered our cost for about 80%, and the rest came from donations. And then this funding was cut.
From one day to the other?
Pretty much, about 4 months. And this was, yeah, really, really, really a hard time, because at this time we didn't know how to survive. And my dad and me, we cut our income at this time half a year. And then in May 2016, we got engaged by the Agentur für Arbeit. So they're now financing our classes for about 80%, and the rest still comes from donations, from, entrepreneurs, private people, foundations. Companies.
And how did you convince the Arbeitsagentur to jump on board?
Well, to be honest, we didn't convince them. It didn't work out for 5 times. We tried it for 5 times, and this is my dad's
core business.
Yeah, profession.
Or expertise.
To find something, to find a paragraph in all these rules that it has, that it works, worked at the end. But it was a really, really, really long way to get this.
How do you find this is, how difficult is it to actually convince non-for-profit investors versus normal investors? Because I guess, what do they get out of it? Mm-hmm. Like, what's mm-hmm. their return, if we can mm-hmm. talk about mm-hmm. return?
So people don't invest in our program because they don't get any money back if they donate. But what happens is that we made a, or the university, or the Technical University in Munich, they made a study about us, and they found out that every euro you give into the program, there come 1.70 euro back to the society within 3 years, only within the first 3 years after release.
So that's a really good return.
Yes, it is.
But how did they calculate this? Like, is it in say, I guess it's savings or?
Yes, several things. Well, one inmate costs us 30,000 euros a year, and there are coming more costs together.
So that's what a prisoner cost to the society, the 30,000, like
true.
the cell and the food and whatever is provided in prison.
Yeah, the personnel stuff, whatever, yes. And if you make out of these people taxpayers and employers and whatever, there's a very positive effect as well. And if you calculate all this, you have
combined two, so it's savings on the actual prison and the savings on police, I guess, on justice, courts.
Right, yes.
Mm. And the fact that also these guys are then paying taxes because they are employed.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, 1.7.
Mm-hmm.
Who wants to invest?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, and so now you're basically financed by the Arbeitsagentur and the rest is donation. So these donators, do you select them or like how do they come? Because I guess you need some certain expertise. Like what is, so if like some people would like to be donators or if they would like to also spend their time in prison a little bit to teach mm-hmm. entrepreneurship, what type of qualification you're looking for?
Mm-hmm. Well, our donors are mostly entrepreneurs because they mm-hmm. understand what we are doing and they are thrilled by the idea. It's something different and yeah, they are fascinated by this. And yeah, if people want to come into our program, we have different events where you can be involved. For example, we have our Ideenvernissage where our participants show their business ideas and you can discuss the business ideas with them and giving inspiration and ideas. Or we're making sales pitch with people. So if you are really a good salesperson, this would be the perfect event for you. Or we are training interviews with the people. So this is a very good role to train the interviews. And some are just interested to see what we are doing there, and they are also invited to come. It's not a zoo, yeah, of course. But
they're high security when you go to all the different.
But just to be interested
doors.
Into the people, into the ideas, into their lives, and coming there and talking to them is a lot. So this also helps.
And if I'm not mistaken, you also have students that help because they don't have access to internet, right? So how do they come up with their business plan?
Yes, yes. Everybody is writing his own business plan. We have computers in prison, but they don't have access to the internet. So our students make market researches for them and we bring the results into prison. So our participants can really write good business plans.
Okay. So looking back now, what you've achieved and the different participants, like what came out of these prisoners? So from the previous intakes, have they actually built companies? Have they, had jobs. So can you share a little bit of some success stories?
We have now 153 graduates. Well, about 11, our reoffending rate is about 11% in comparison to 46% in normal.
So you're saying half, like in Germany, half of the inmates are going back to prison?
Yes, within the first 3 years.
And that rate was the Leonhard participants?
Is 11% at the moment, yes. 29% of our participants or of our graduates found their own company, and 60% find a new occupation after release after 26 days. So it works, yes.
It's pretty good achievements. And what are they doing? Do you have like...
It's really different. Like you said before, there's one who's really successful having a search engine optimization company. Another one has a mobile tattoo studio. Another one is a PC trainer. So the range is really, really big.
Okay, and have they found investors, or how do they finance this actually?
Sometimes, but most of them start without a lot of money. So we encourage them to find a business idea which doesn't need too much money. But if you come out of prison and say, okay, I can start, I only need $1 million, it doesn't work. Nobody gives you the money.
The next unicorn.
yes. So you have to find ideas which you can build up with just short money. This is important for them. Yes.
Going back now on the other side, like the setbacks, the failure, what, like through this experience of I guess 7 years, were there any deception, any things that you regret or that didn't go as expected? And
well, I don't really regret anything, but there were hard times, of course. As I mentioned before, our first class, we started with 9 people. After 6 weeks, there were only 3 people left.
What was the reason?
Yes, we didn't have enough experience how to recruit the right people. And right means at this time that they are ready to take responsibility and that they're ready to change their lives. And at the same time, there was the rumor in prison that we are from Scientology. So we had to redefine the picture about our program. And then we were happy because then we found new people who joined the program, and we had a stable group of seven persons, and we are still in a very good contact with them. So they're really, really sticking.
And some of them actually even joined Leonhard as employees.
Yes, as employees or as donors. We are still very connected. And another very challenging time was when I was on parental leave. I have 2 kids, 2 boys. They are 2 and 3 years old. And when I was on parental leave with my second son, my colleague was also on parental leave, and the team was not very well integrated, and the funding was cut at this moment. So this was bad timing.
Combination of everything that goes
wrong. Yeah, true. Then I decided, and my son was only 6 months old, I decided to return to work earlier than I thought before, because I wanted to stay longer with him, but I had to go back and save together with my father the program.
And to remotivate your team members.
Yes, true. Yes.
How do you do this actually when you struggle, when you have such a struggle about not having any financing? How do you push them to continue? Because do they see the vision that you have, or?
Yes, we see the people and we see how it works. And my dad and me, we are really a very strong team. And we have I have to say this in German, zusammenverhauen das ganze Dorf. That's what we said in these times. Okay, now we try it once again and once again and once again. And then
so a bit stubborn in a good way. Mm-hmm. And how is it to work with your father, actually? Like, because a lot of people also like do some entrepreneurial activities as family business. Mm-hmm. Is that something that is, I'm guessing, is something that empowered you to bring it to life versus hindering?
We are really working at eye level, and I would say that we are really colleagues when we are at work, and not so much father and daughter. And of course, I benefit from his experiences a lot. Sometimes he benefits from my experience as well. And yeah, we didn't have a lot of time during my childhood together because he was working every time. We had a close relationship, but not a lot of time. And now we have more time together, and we are doing this thing together, which we really like. So we are both enjoying this partnership very much.
Good. So are we expecting now a second Leonhard in any other prison in Deutschland, in Germany?
Yes, maybe, maybe. So we are now making a strategy consulting company. Is making a pro bono project together with us to make a strategy how we can roll out this program to other states in Germany. And yeah, maybe in one year I can say more about that.
Perfect. Mm-hmm. But then I would love to have you again in 1 year to tell how this went. Any questions from the audience? At this time, I think we can switch off the camera. Thanks.